First, I'll start. My name is Andre, and I'm a C++ developer for the last 20 years. Here's my contact information. You can see the logo all over the places. I keep using it. The yet another fast log is a mechanism which makes logs quick in your runtime, in your main thread, the place that you need to log quickly and not stop the working thread. It's applicable in situation where the application that you have many times it's either doing its job or log about it, but you can see both. You don't see it. If you want to see all the messages, then the application will not run. This mechanism gives you the ability to log everything, all the things that you need. In many cases, people restrict the logs by severity, by models, by many kinds of situations, techniques to reduce the number of logs. But this mechanism gives you the ability to log everything because it's really, really fast. Another thing that other log mechanism, you need to work for them. You need to build structure outside the code and then use these structures inside the code. This mechanism gives you a very convenient way to log your messages easily in the code, and that's it. The log itself comes into a very simple message, just a log with your severity and the message itself, the text itself, with variables, with strings, with everything. And the main the main technique here is to use pre-processing to make the code a binary, to switch your strings, to switch everything into binaries, into a long. You just log everything. You log everything as long. All your messages become long, and then you have a binary file which is very fast to write. Afterwards, you have a post-processing just to translate again this log into a string which are human readable. The pre-process itself is I used M4 to do it. Maybe if we have time, we'll see it. And the pre-process just creates two things. It generates map file, which map your text into binaries, into numbers. It adds some metadata on the messages. And yes, it generates the map and generate the code with the correct binaries itself. We'll see it in a minute. One of the major achievement, which I wrote here, is to keep the line of your text in the correct place. It was very hard because preprocessors are very generous with spaces and new lines. And if you have your message, which you wrote it, you see it here. If you wrote your message, let's say that this message is written in, written in line 17, then you want to see in the log file the message in line 17. It gives you the ability to go back into your source code in the correct place. But preprocessors, as I said, are very generous in adding spaces. So one of the major challenges. Yes. One of the major challenges was to keep the line in the same place, and you'll see later maybe. So okay, let's go out here. Another one. Okay, so you the preprocessor takes the your log message, your normal log message, and convert it into two files. One is the binary file with the binary. It's the source code, which is like binary with a number, and the other one is the map file. Okay, so the preprocessor takes it and split your code into a map file. If you take a look here, you have a number which represents the file name itself, another number which represents the string demo, message per second, and so on. And the other thing is the code itself, which is written into the binary area, but it's a code, which have a message with numbers. Everything here is a number. We build a log object with all the numbers that we want to log. It's just it is just a structure with numbers. That's what the compiler sees. Wizard, yes, wizard the keys to the map, exactly. Now at compile time, we compile this code. Let's see. The compiler sees this code, doesn't see our code that we wrote in the beginning. We take all the entire code base is translated into code, like binary code. It's still code, but binary. Then in the execute time, we just write the binary file itself. It's a binary log with all the numbers. All the numbers are just written into the file as binary. At runtime, with very low footprint on the working thread. And once we have this binary log file in the file system, we need a reader to read it. The reader itself combines the map file that we created in the compile time and the binary file itself, the binary log file itself, read it and translate it into a readable text with all the information that we wrote in the beginning.
What is the string?
The output of the compilation process, of the build process, is two things. It's the map file and your binary, your regular binary. Okay? So your string is kept in the map file. Okay. Only constant strings are available. Not constant. No. This is part of the limitation. I didn't map into it, but dynamic strings cannot be logged. Okay, dynamic strings cannot be logged. Okay. Numbers, yes, of course, variables. Variables are just written to the log file as they are. Variables, as they are, as you just add your, if we take a look here. Currently, I give a pre-talk. This project was started as a POC to a working server that couldn't produce all the logs that we wanted it to produce. So it started as a POC, and it was a success, but the entire project, not the log itself, the entire project was thrown away. So it didn't get into a working stage. It's not that much mature. Okay, but so it's working only with logs at the moment, only with longs. Maybe I'm not familiar with it. Maybe there's already a tool like this, but here what the main advantage that I kept is that let me go into when I build everything with CMake. One moment, let's get into there. One moment. Okay. The regular process of code, compile, run, and analyze is kept for the user. You don't have to do anything special as a programmer. Okay, so you get everything wrapped up with CMake, build, you just build your code, run your executable, and get the logs with using the reader.
Do I understand correctly that the items of information in the log are static strings through an index to the ordering or no.
Yes, that's correct. The question was if I can log what I can log, and the answer is yes. It's static strings and longs. Everything that be can be yeah can be converted to long.
So if I'm producing say I want to convert to the way I'm logging things using printf style format experience. So I would give each of these format strings an index. That would be logged into the file, the index of the format string, and each of the parameters, which I might convert each one and go along, those would be logged as well.
Okay, so if I just try to translate your question into a wider one, the question is how do I format the output string at the end? I want to format the string, I want to make it look pretty, look nice at the final log, how do I do it? This is the question. Okay, so there are many possibilities to do it. Mainly you need to log your in your tools, your indexes, your whatever it is that makes you know how to produce the output at the end into a binary, and then write a smarter reader it will read these signs and your and format your log. Okay, so the idea is to log everything binary, not to log any string or anything which is a variable size, just blocks of known size binaries. Okay, so the formatting will be at the end, at the reader, and you need to give it signs how to do it. Okay, let's see. So we talked about CMake, but we didn't talk about a bit about benchmarks. Benchmarks are very hard to create benchmarks, good benchmarks. Don't believe anyone when they tell you about speed. I got about 5 million messages per second. If I don't output them, actually don't output them, I get more than double the speed of messages, but just try it yourself and see if it works for you, okay? How do I print it? The actual write? It's F-write. F-write of block, of a chunk. I write every X messages, 100,000 or something like that. That's Python. No, it's a different thread. All the threading is okay, good question. If we go into the log itself, the actual call to the log here, you can see that I'm pushing into a queue, log queue push. So I construct a log structure, log class, and then I push it into a queue. Okay, multiple threads makes lock, and you have lock there. Okay, one of the things that can make this log even faster is to log each working thread into its own binary file, and then do the merge of everything at the end, at the reader. Okay, and then you can gain even faster. Okay, now I'm using just the same queue. It's one queue, log queue push. It's a public member G log queue. It's a public member that just logs everything. The timestamps are saved in the when the messages are popped out of the queue. The timestamp that you see here, down here, are the timestamp of the popped message out of the queue. It's not a problematic because you don't have any way to control it in anyhow. If you have two working threads, you just don't know when the timestamp was given. You just don't know it. In the creation of the log itself, of the log object itself, it's possible. It's possible, but then it can't be const expert. And I find it very useful to get them in the way in the time that were in the log itself. Again, every specific project may have its needs, its specific needs. Again, if you have two working threads and each one of them stamps the time by its own, Okay, you still don't know which one happened first.
Yes.
No, it might be that this the work was done, just was done a bit of the log. The log itself doesn't do any work. Okay, the work was done a bit at this moment. When you get this context switch, you get the timestamp of this one, and then you get the timestamp of the other one. The way if you are getting into the log itself, I can tell you about the timestamp a bit more. When I try to make it even faster, I decided not to call the operating system to get the time for every log. I just called it every 1,000 message or something like this, and I get even quicker logs. Okay, but then I get 1,000 messages with the same timestamp. And you want to use the log for it? Okay, so timestamp we can discuss other. Let me. Okay, just I'll just go quickly over the things that are still in this presentation because I worked on it. Let's see. I think I talked about everything. The CMake has a huge impact. Using CMake as the build system has a huge impact on the ability of doing it, because CMake is very, very nicely work with everything. Okay. This is the M4, and for the Hebrew speakers, if you think that compilers are bad, preprocessor הם פסיכופטים לחלוטין, מאוד קשה לעבוד איתם. So this is the code of the M4. It looks awful because it's awful. It's one of the areas that you don't want to get into maintenance with them. Everything must be at the exact place with all. Or any space here gets you a space in the output, and every new line will get a new line in the output which you don't want it, because you want to keep the lines at the correct place. Lots of comments, very useful. Do it. Will not help. It will help you a bit. And the CMake itself, we have a custom command that creates a generator. This generator, when you run it, creates This generator creates the output of both the, of course, the M4, and creates both the code area and the map area. It's split it into two files. One of the original code with the binary text, and the other one is the map that we saw. So it's very nice. If you look at the running of CMake, it's not CMake itself. You generate the generator, then you run the generator, and it generates the file itself. Okay, and then just when it compiles the code, so it adds into the build procedure another two steps. That's it.